Okay. So I'm going to start with prayer. And then, like I said, and then I'm going to share a little bit. And then we're all going to share for the rest of the evening. Okay. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful that we're here together. And we do lift up Wanda to you. We thank you for the gift that she is to this ministry, the gift that she is to the children that she ministers to, the gift she is to the world, Lord. She's just an amazing person. And so we ask today that you would hide her from the enemy, that you would protect her, and that during this time, while she's having to stay home from work, that you would just give her deep and profound rest, but at the same time, be able to get her schoolwork done without the pressure on her. So Lord, we know you have great plans for Vonda when she finishes up her degree, and we just ask that you would go before her to confirm whatever direction that is. And Lord, we thank you for the time we've had together this summer in this practicum class, and we just, gosh, we cherish our time together, Lord. We love you, we love each other, and so tonight we are just expecting a great blessing among each other tonight. We pray this in your name, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Well, this morning, one of the things that we've been working with in the trauma group that we're doing is just helping them understand the whole fight, flight, freeze thing and how that works in our bodies and the need to pendulate, remember that term, to go from when you're highly activated to be able to come out of that to a place of deactivation. And so we do lots of things to practice that. And tonight, I'm looking you over. I don't see a whole lot of you that I think are highly activated right now, but you could be hiding that. But I want you to just take a minute and notice any sensations in your body, especially sensations of discomfort of any kind, where there might be tightness or achy or pain or tension. Notice your heart rate. Notice your breathing. And maybe just even scale yourself on a 1 to 10. How intense is the dis-ease or discomfort in your body right now? So I'll just give you a minute to get aware of that. Be aware of that. Hi, Susanna. I was just giving everybody the assignment of kind of doing a body scan and noticing any places of stiffness, pain, discomfort.
Okay.
Yeah, noticing your breath and all those things that we've been doing for a while. And scale it on a scale 1 to 10. Where are you at right now? And just keep that in mind.
Okay.
Okay. So now, we've done a lot of exercises where you pendulate out of the activation and in your body and over to something that is pleasant. And so we're going to do some work with that tonight a little bit. And that's part of what I'm going to have you be sharing about a little bit later. But we need to, all of us, get really creative in and of ourselves and for ourselves. But then we can also use what we learn about ourselves to pass it on to others, use it in counseling sessions, use it on the street, use it with your kids, use it with your husband. Anybody that might stress you out, But learning how to recognize when our bodies are physically activated, because then that affects our emotions and that affects our thoughts. And so if you do have some tension or pain or something in your body, you might be noticing some negative thoughts that are kind of tuned into that, or some uncomfortable emotions. So I'm going to use one thing, and I probably a number of you have already seen this or heard it, but it's so delightful that I don't care how many hundreds of times I have watched this video, I get goosebumps and often cry. But to me, it's a delightful way to, it's even part of grief. Of remembering someone that's not in your life anymore, remembering, you know, whether it's through death or some kind of loss or whatever. But listen to the words of the song, but also watching it is just absolutely delightful. So I'm going to share my screen. And here we go.
Here's to the ones that we got. Cheers to the wish you were here, but you're not, cause the dreams bring back all the memories of everything we've been through.
Close to the ones here today.
Close to the ones that we lost on the way, cause the dreams bring back all the memories,
and the memories bring back you.
There's a time that I remember, when I did not know no pain,
when I believed in forever, and everything would stay the same.
Now my heart feel like December, when somebody say your name,
cause I can't reach out to call you, but I know I will one day. Yeah.
Everybody hurts sometimes.
Everybody hurts someday.
Yeah.
But everything will be alright.
Go with your voice and say,
hey. Here's to the ones that we got.
Cheers to the wish you were here, but you're not. Cause the dreams
bring back all the memories of everything we've been through.
Close to the ones here today.
Close to the ones that we lost on the way.
Cause the dreams bring back all the memories
back.
Memories bring back you.
There's a time that I remember, when I never felt so lost,
when I felt that all the hatred was too powerful to stop.
Now my heart feels like an ember,
and it's lighting up the dark.
I'll carry these torches for you,
that you know I'll never drop.
Yeah.
Everybody hurts sometimes.
Everybody hurts someday.
Hey, hey.
But everything gon' be alright.
Go and raise your voice and say,
hey.
Here's to the ones that we got.
Cheers to the wish you were here, but you're not.
Cause the dreams bring back all the memories
of everything we've been through.
Close to the ones here today.
Close to the ones that we lost on the way.
Cause the dreams bring back all the memories.
And the memories bring back, memories bring back you.
Memories bring back, memories bring back.
Okay. So now notice, what did you experience?
We smiled.
We got hijacked.
Oh, wait. I think I might. There we are. Yeah. Sorry about that. It went on to the next YouTube thing. Yeah. So anyway, you know, I had you notice what your body was experiencing before we started did that music. And then I noticed, was there any shift, any change? What did you experience physically? I see Sherry Dunnigan experienced something.
Well, for me, I love music, and that's classical. And so I enjoyed the classical part of it. But in thinking about memories, it made me think of my dad, and I miss him.
Yeah.
And so it wasn't unpleasant. It wasn't like it was a pleasant memory because it's true. Even though he's gone, I still have memories. And he's been gone for, 17 years.
Mm-hmm.
But I still miss him.
Mm-hmm. And so physically, Sherry, what did you experience in your body?
I'm crying.
Mm-hmm.
Because I'm happy because he's in heaven, but I miss him.
Mm-hmm.
And so for me, it was too, to be honest, I was looking at these kids thinking, have they lost people? I'm thinking through my mind, I'm going, is this kind of COVID kind of thing? Like maybe they've lost people during COVID. So my mind was going there too. So that added to a little bit of sorrow, thinking that it's hard on children when they lose people they love, parents, grandparents, aunties, uncles. So I was thinking about that too. So I added to that sadness.
That's an example of, there's activation there, but it's not necessarily a negative activation. You know, that there can be a pleasantness even in the grief.
I should hop in here and just say, I just relaxed. I had done some yard work this morning and I was sore. And so my shoulder's a little sore and everything. And I just relaxed. And, you know, I don't feel quite as sore. I'm sure it'll come back at me. But in that time, I just relaxed. And it's like all of the stress just kind of melted right off of me. And the other thing was, we've recently with my family, it seems like every time we get together, we just share all these funny stories. And then what happens is they come up with new ones because I do crazy things. So the most recent one is I told my son, I asked him if he had left his phone in the car. And I said, did you get your car in the phone? And so they thought that was really funny that I would mix up the two words. Well, I'm always doing something like that. So, but that just adds to, you know, their strove of funny memories that they have, that we always wind up telling these funny stories, and we just have a whole bunch of them for all of us. So I just thought how fun that is. And it's a good thing in a family. It's a very good thing.
Yeah, fun stories and laughter in a family can be a very healing piece. Yeah. Who else wants to share? What did you experience? And think of the contrast of how you were feeling before. That's why I asked you to scale it. And then what happened to you as you listened to that song?
I'll share. So this week has been really a stressful go, 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 go week. My family has needed me more than usual. And so that's a lot. And so I rushed in here to be on this Zoom call, and I wasn't really ready. And I had some aches and pains and tightness in my chest just because I was hurrying and stressed, and I wasn't ready. But when we were listening to it, I wasn't aware. I mean, I physically was not aware of any aches and pains or tightness in my chest. I wasn't aware of it at all. And towards the end, well, I kept thinking, oh, this is amazing. I've got to show this to, you know, I thought of all kinds of people that need to see this. And, but towards the end, I just caught myself taking a really big breath and sigh of release.
Mm-hmm. That's an example of your nervous system moving into the parasympathetic. Who else wants to share?
I can. I was triggered. At first, I was just enjoying the music. It was so beautiful, and the artistry, you know, the how they synchronized that, even though they were all in different locations and did that online, was just amazing. And it was beautiful. And then I started really taking in the lyrics and remembering some of my significant losses, and then remembering some friends who are in a very, very dangerous place right now.
Yeah.
And may be killed.
Mm-hmm.
Today could be going on right now. And so I was triggered.
Yeah. Can we stop and pray for your friends?
Sure.
Are those friends in Afghanistan?
Yes.
Yes, let's pray.
Yeah. Deanna, you want to lead that?
Yes. Father, you are a great and a mighty God. And we just love you, and you are so awesome. And first of all, Father, I just want to come to you, and I just want to repent. Please forgive us, Lord, for the complaints that we make. Mm-hmm. We live in such comfort. We live in such safety, yet we are complainers and murmurers. Please forgive us, Lord. And we lift up our brothers and sisters that are in such dangerous situations, and we cry out to you. We cry out to you, Lord, that you would, Lord, that you would bring healing, that you would bring safety. Lord, that you would, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Oh, Father, we just cry out to you. We ask that you will provide for our friends in Afghanistan, that somehow, some way, you'll miraculously keep them safe. Father, if you choose to bring some of them home, I pray for their families that you will, and their friends, that you will provide for them and enable them to be able to praise you in the midst of the agony, in the midst of the loss. But Lord, most of all, we pray for your protection. We pray that you would just move by your Spirit. Yes. Thy will be done, Father. Thy will be done.
Yes, Father. Hide them, Father, under your wings.
Yes, yes.
And Lord, we ask that you'd comfort Marion too. and all of those who are the families and the loved ones of those who are still left in Afghanistan, and they're in such fear. And Lord, I've talked to soldiers, Afghan veterans, and they are going through so much trauma right now watching all of this. And even some of the Vietnam vets watching this happen as a reenactment for them.
Yes.
So we lift up these men and women who have served and are so torn by this. And we pray, Father, that you would bring comfort, that you would bring wisdom and truth and rest, whatever it is that they need personally, Lord. Provide resources, provide support.
Yes.
Provide somebody who can come alongside them and hear them and see them.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord.
And Lord Jesus, I pray against fear.
Mm-hmm.
Lord Jesus, I pray that our brothers and sisters there in Afghanistan would stand with your armor on, and that they would be witnesses for you, that you would do mighty things in the midst of this. You know what's going on. You're in control no matter what things look like, Lord. But there are people who are going to reach out and grasp onto you, get to know you through their witness. So, Lord God, I pray that they would stand strong, because and that the joy of the Lord would be their strength in the midst of it, that people would see around them that there's only one way and one hope, and it's through you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Yes, I come and agree with my sisters that you provide, that you help them be strong in the midst of this, and that you could send your angels around them and protect them. Your will be done no matter what happens. I pray for all those who don't know you, that they would come to know you. Lord, it's possible even for that Taliban leader to get to know you. You did that with Nikki Cruz. You can certainly do it with these leaders. Lord, I pray for salvation in Jesus' name.
Yes, Lord. Yes. Thank you, Father. Amen. Amen. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Anybody else want to share?
I would share about Nick's reaction, my husband, Nick.
Uh-huh.
He was a Vietnam vet. He asked me if I had seen the video of the people running to the plane.
Mm-hmm.
He started to cry.
Yeah.
Because he said he has been on those planes. They are so huge. He was on them with soldiers to the back, facing the back, and all their vehicles in the middle. And when he said, don't look at it, the scene of the people running to the plane, and he said he thought there were 1,000 people in that plane.
Wow. Yeah, we need to just really keep gosh, I have so many people, the people that are there, the people that are here, the people that have been in Afghanistan. It's pretty desperate. Marian, I think it's interesting, you know, that, well, I chose that song for one, but that you're going to be teaching on grief and children.
Yeah.
So when level two, three class is going to start again September 2nd. And next week, I'm going to be sending out the letters and everything. And those of you that have been there a couple years already or a year and you are and graduated or whatever, you are always welcome to join that class at any time. And I just need to know to keep you on the email list. You know, Vicki, you're one of those that you've been through the class a couple of times and you're starting to counsel, and Christy, you're starting to counsel, and of course Ruth Ann and Marion. But I just want you to know you are always welcome to join the class, and you don't have to do the homework after you've graduated.
Lucky you guys.
But Marion's going to do her special interest report on grief and children. And that will be the, I think it's the 9th of September. It's my wedding anniversary. Yeah.
How many years, Cindy?
I'll be 49.
Ooh. We just did 48.
Did you? Well, I figure it's a miracle, and it is by the grace of God, absolutely and only.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
We got married thinking, oh, we'll get married and live happily ever after. Well, nobody told us she had to work at this thing. So, like I say, I want tonight to just be a night of sharing. And if we get done early, that's fine. And, but let me see how many we got on here tonight. 2, 4, 6, 8, 7, 9. Because I'm thinking of putting you guys into breakout rooms on screen. And I would like the topic to be along these lines of what of finding, looking for resources in and of yourself. And so start with, what are my resources? What are those, where are those places I can go either physically or in my head to turn on that parasympathetic nervous system, to turn on the relaxation response, to turn on that peace in my nervous system that helps me come down out of anxiety or come out of the freeze thing. So we've all developed some of those things within ourselves, and it can be anything from music and dance and movement and
horseback riding,
hobbies of any kind. You know, I see Frida doing her crocheting. That's one of those things. Sometimes it's sports or animals, or it might be camping or fishing or whatever types of activities you like to do. And it might be and get really creative with it. You know, what brings a sense of just that relief, that letdown, that thing that brings calm in? Because you want to learn to deliberately take yourself there, to put yourself in that. And one of the things that I do quite frequently is, and I think we've done it in this class, is having you close your eyes and create a place in your mind where you go. For me, it's in a meadow in Sumter on my horse, running bareback. I doubt I could do that anymore, but in my head I can. I have several scenarios that I go to. Sometimes I go to the beach. Sometimes it's the mountain meadows. There's usually always running water somewhere or running horses. But I want you to, well, I'm going to put you into breakout rooms, and I want you to brainstorm some of those things. And so brainstorming would be each one of you take the time to share what some of your experiences are and learn from each other, because you want to have as big a repertoire as you can have. Simple things from reading or watching a movie to the more complex of visualizing something or actually going out and doing some activity or something. Does this make sense? Mm-hmm. Because the more we do it for ourselves, then the better we're going to be to help our clients resource. It's one of the things that you're going to begin looking for constantly when you're working with somebody is, okay, identify what's some of their resources. And you might just pick it up in a conversation. You know, you're just kind of chit-chatting before the session starts. And it's like, okay, she has a cat. I think she likes her cat. That's a resource. Getting to know their hobbies and likes and dislikes and people that they like and all kinds of stuff. So I need to look at my breakout rooms. I'm not sure how long I have them set up for. Options. So I'm gonna allow about 15 minutes because I'm only gonna divide you into a couple of groups. So there'll be three or four of you in a group. Or maybe even five. Maybe I'll put you in three groups. One, two, three. Okay, is everybody ready? And you'll get a warning when there's a minute left. And then we will come back here and we will share our resources and we'll talk about what's coming up with counselor training and in the ministry.
So we're brainstorming about what things help us calm down, basically.
Yep.
Okay.
Pretty much.
I've started a list.
All righty. I'm going to open the rooms, and I think you have to click join to go to it, okay? Here we go. Okay. So we're a group.
Yes, we're a group.
Yes, we are.
Those are skills.
Okay, I'm trying.
You cut us short.
Okay, I think we're all back. How was that? Did you have a good time?
That was fun.
Yeah, we had a good time. So I'd like every person to share tonight, and you can share about what you did in your group, or you can share, I don't care what you share. We got time, but I think it's important, but I really do want to spend some time talking about what we just did too. And maybe I will start because I want to emphasize the importance of this. That it is so critical that we develop this repertoire of being able to swing into the parasympathetic nervous system because we live such a frenzied pace in this generation. Teresa and I were talking about the pace here at Good Samaritan Ministries and how, you know, it started back in the 70s. And in the 70s, Betty wrote hundreds, thousands of letters to people around the world, and she would dictate them, and then somebody here at the office would type them up and send them out for her. But we were saying how she did this communication, but there was like a 2-month lag. She'd write a letter, and it takes a month to go overseas. They write a letter back, and it takes another month to get back. And it's like, we're doing 40 emails a day back and forth. And it gives you a little perspective of the stress that we're under. I'm not saying just here at the ministry, but as you know, how many of you get inundated with emails, whether it's trash or whatever, but we're on information overload for the most part. We're being barraged constantly by media stuff, and it is very stressful to our nervous systems. And so we need to be very proactive about deactivating our nervous systems. And that's why I played that song tonight. And looking at that contrast of what happens when I listen to music, and the type of music is going to make a huge difference. It depends on what you listen to as a child. You may have a negative connection to some music. I know when I came to the Lord, I'd been in the cowboy world for quite a while, and I rodeoed and spent a lot of time doing ungodly things. And I was really into country music. I had to stop listening to country music for years, because every time I'd listen to it, it drug me back into thoughts in a world where I didn't have any business being. I can listen to it now. And of course, I don't necessarily listen to the country music that was from the 60s and 70s anymore. So I love Garth Brooks, by the way. but music is powerful for good or evil. So be careful what we listen to. Be careful. There's even a proverb that says, be careful what you set your eyes on. They knew TV was coming. That's why I wrote that. They knew computers were coming. Be careful what you set your eyes on, because it's going into your brain. It's affecting your nervous system. It's affecting your thinking. It's addictive. And even happy ones can be addictive. I mean, how many women have been hooked on romance novels and soap operas? You know, soap operas were kind of women's pornography, and there's a lot of romance novels that are too, but now women are probably, many of them, as addicted as men to real pornography, because it is so available, and it is immediate addiction, because it dumps chemicals into your body that addict you very quickly. So be careful what we listen to. Be careful what we put our eyes on. Terry and I were flipping through Netflix looking for a movie to watch, and picked this one called The Deep Blue Sea. Well, don't watch it if you want to sleep, okay? I do not watch horror movies, for one, but I like action adventure stuff. Well, this one was a little too much action. It was like the sharks killed all but about two people in the show. And but notice when you're watching a movie, notice your physiology. You're watching that movie, and if it's a high adrenaline part of the movie, and the music in the background is generated to make you engage emotionally, physiologically with that movie. So it's as though you're experiencing what it is that you're watching, you know? And a lot of people are really hooked on that. They love that feeling of watching horror movies.
No, thank you.
A lot of us say no, thank you, but know that a lot of people you're working with, they are addicted to it, and they do love it. They love the adrenaline kick and what it gives to them. And it's not our place to judge that, but we need to notice it.
Well, I have to say that even though I don't really like those kind of movies, I get pretty excited about adrenaline. I was teaching a strength training class, and my first few times I was talking to my mentor about it, and she was saying, yeah, I know it, like by the end of the class we're just really amped up because you have all this adrenaline, uh-huh. you know, right? And she goes, it's just our little secret.
Uh-huh.
But it's like this little drug.
Uh-huh. And that's not all bad.
Yeah.
You know, it's okay to go there in healthy ways, and as long as it's not in an addiction. I mean, we can be addicted to athletic things and sports stuff to an unhealthy point too. We can do anything to excess. But anyway, it's keep noticing, notice when you're watching movies, notice the music that brings calming effect to you. Notice the music that ramps you up. Sometimes it's like, I get up every morning and I put on, it's called relaxing piano music, but it's, a lot of it is worship music, and it's just all instrumental, mostly piano, very calming. And so I wake up with that. But then as I get closer to getting ready to get out the door, I put on contemporary Christian music or worship music. And then when I get in the car, I turn it off. And this is what we were talking about when you guys started coming back on, is proclaiming the scripture. There is a difference. We can say we pray the scripture, and we can pray asking, oh Lord, please anoint me, Lord, please give me this, Lord, grant me wisdom, and we're making these requests. But what plugs in your parasympathetic nervous system, and I think actually accomplishes something in the kingdom of God, is to begin proclaiming the scripture, declaring it. Thank you, Father God, that you have anointed me. Thank you that you freely give me wisdom. Thank you, Father, that you delight in working through me, that you have sent your Holy Spirit, that your Spirit is as rivers of living water in me. You love to give me your voice. You love to minister to me and through me, that you delight that I want to be your hands and feet and mouth. So begin declaring those things, and you can feel the presence of the Holy Spirit engage you. And so it's a good activation, but it can also be that calming that brings me out of anxiety and gives me peace. So for me, that is probably my greatest go-to. I've had seasons in my life where I've written out specific scriptures that address my needs at the time. And when I had been through like 5 miscarriages, thought I would never be able to have children. And this was when I first came to the Lord. And after we were married like 9 years, actually it was 8 years, Terry was in chiropractic college. I was begging the Lord to give me a son. Lord, I wasn't just asking for a child, I wanted a son. It's like, I want a boy first and then a girl, because that's the way I grew up. Every girl needs a big brother to be a protector, was my philosophy. But anyway, so I cried out to the Lord. And lo and behold, one day I'm at work and I'm actually was running the stairs for exercise on my break. And I was pondering the scripture in John 15:7 that says, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish and it'll be done for you. And so I kept pondering that scripture, and I said, okay, Lord, what of your word do you want to abide in me for today? And within 15 minutes, he downloaded all this scripture about childbearing, and I could still quote most of it to this day, and this was 40 years ago. And I took all of that scripture and I typed it up on a piece of paper and I hung it in front of my typewriter at work and I put it on my refrigerator at home. And this was totally out of character for me at the time. And I started telling everybody, the Lord says I'm going to have a baby. And Terry's like, oh, well, I guess we'll see. But I knew. And I began declaring and proclaiming those scriptures over and over and over until I could they were just part of me. I was abiding in them, and those words were abiding in me. And lo and behold, I mean, this was in like April or May. And by December, my body had totally changed my menstrual cycles. I went from having horrifying, awful cycles, blood clots, and in bed for several days to 28 days, 5 days of flow, no pain. And in December, I got pregnant. And I had a son the following September. Imagine that. Anyway, there was a whole lot more to the story, but to me, that was probably one of the greatest lessons of the power of the Word of God in my life. And that it is very much that, you know, we look at the supernatural of it, and it was very supernatural, and it was Holy Spirit. But at the same time, we have to look at how the word literally affects our physiology. The word of God can change your physiology. It can change you from being amped up and climbing the walls or dead flat and depressed. It can transform your physiology and your thoughts and your emotions. And you don't have to feel it when you begin saying it. I was telling these ladies in the room here that when I started, when the Lord gave me Isaiah 61 to quote, when I was a totally inept, knew nothing, brand new counselor, and I started, you know, it's like the devil's going, who the hell do you think you are? You don't know anything. And the Lord said, well, I think you're my kid, and I have anointed you to bring good news to the afflicted, to bind up the wounds of the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to captives and freedom to prisoners, to declare the favorable day of the Lord and the day of vengeance of our God. And I would wake up in the morning with that dark cloud over my head, accusing me and telling me how much I didn't know. And the Lord said, it doesn't matter. I'm in you. It's me doing it. So just go along here. But that's what took me to the office every day when I felt totally inept. And so when you have those dark, foreboding thoughts that grab hold of you, the word of God, and not just wishing it, not begging for it or pleading it, proclaiming it. Declaring it is. I have been crucified with Christ. It's no longer me that lives. It's Christ in me. So proclaim it with confidence. Or proclaim it without confidence. The confidence will come. It comes in the proclaiming, in the declaring. Because he says it. And you know, in that scripture in John 15, it says, if my words abide in you, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, that is rhema. It is the spoken word of God, R-H-E-M-A. It is the Greek word for he has spoken that word directly to me. So whenever you get that inkling of the Holy Spirit speaking to you, you know, you're reading the Bible and that paragraph just jumps off the page and it's totally out of context, but it has your name written all over it. Grab that. I have several Bibles where when that happens to me, I date it. I write the date beside it in my Bible, and I can go back and it's like I can proclaim those scriptures today the same as I did 30 years ago. They're just as powerful. So when the Lord speaks to you, it is a word for eternity. Don't let it go. Don't go, oh, that was nice. And I got to say, through the years, I've kept sporadic journals through the years. And I would go back and I would read those journals and go, oh, my gosh, I forgot all about that. you know? And it's like I had laid my sword down. Pick the sword up. Use it. So that was quite a lengthy explanation, but I think it's important. I think it is so critical that I think I'm just now coming into the realization of how powerful it, now that I understand trauma and how it works, how powerful it is in overcoming trauma, in overcoming the high activation in our nervous systems, that we have the empathetic witness in us. It's great when somebody with skin on comes and holds our hands and listens to us and is there, but the Holy Spirit is there. Yeah. Okay, I'm going to shut up now and let you guys share.
wait a minute, Cindy, say that again. Did you say, what did you say is within us?
The empathetic witness. And okay. I get that from Peter Levine's training. Peter Levine uses that term. He says that one of the key elements of healing from trauma is to have an empathetic witness. Somebody who comes alongside us. And it's like, it is the description of the Holy Spirit, but it is also the description of what God is training us to do as his ambassadors and as healers, as counselors. We are that empathetic witness when we're sitting and listening to the life history of somebody.
That's amazing for me to hear, because the last couple of weeks, the Lord has been really speaking to me that we need to develop the art of empathy.
Yes. Good word. The art of empathy.
Yes.
Yeah, I like that. Who feels compelled to share? Lorna.
It was just a little thing when you were saying about you forgot things that had happened. We had this God's bag. And when you have a worry or concern, you have a bag that is like an envelope or a box or whatever. And you write down your concern, and in putting it in the God's bag or box, you are giving it to God to handle. And if you want to take it out and go back and try and handle it yourself, you can do that. But usually what's happened is it helps to, you know, physically give it to God. And we've had experience when, you know, we put things in there that are really heavy and really hard to deal with, and then we've just forgotten about it. And then you go back in 6 months or something and you go, oh, that's handled and that's handled and that's handled. Oh. And it lifted it off of your shoulders because you did a physical act of giving it to God.
Yeah, I love it. That fits for those of you, probably a number of you were here when Betty taught on Monday. And she was teaching on experiential learning. And this, that's a great example of an experiential exercise.
Yeah.
Something that engages you physically.
Yeah.
Yeah. I love that.
Yeah.
I thought it was neat that our group had horses in their lives. All of us did. And so we could really relate to one another and bond with one another through our experiences.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And again, that's another experiential
healing way. Yeah.
You guys just need to jump in and start sharing, okay?
Cindy, in our group, we talked about a bunch of things, but one of the things that came up was that I had an issue with falling into a calming thing that wasn't so healthy. Mm. Falling kind of backward and going back to old habits that were not so good. So that's eating for me. And so finding, you know, crocheting and writing and light exercise and worship and all of those things that are positive, that are good things, and learning to set aside the not so good things. We talked briefly about helping our clients to identify those really positive things. And then if things showed up that were not so positive, helping to identify those things as well, just so that it would clarify to the client something that is a healthy and good way to calm down, to relax, to feel good about yourself. And not fall into something that's going to be not so good. And you touched on that on some of your things, that music or anything can be a good thing, but it can be also not so good thing if taken to extreme, or if you're focusing on the wrong aspect of it or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
But Hannah brought up a really good thing. She talked about becoming a part of a community, a group of people, and meeting together and just being that support where someone can come with a heavy heart and then through just listening to each other and visiting and then worshiping God together and having a little bite to eat and just experiencing this together in community really makes a difference. And it really does deactivate all those painful things. And by the time you're ready to leave, you're not hurting anymore at all. So mm-hmm. We really loved that. Both of us, Sherry and I, just really loved that. We just kind of grabbed a hold of that one. So thank you.
Good. Good. And I like that you brought up the thing that we can actually do self-soothing things that aren't good for us, you know, and that's where, you know, it's like the Bible doesn't say anything about masturbation, but that's one of those things that can be used to, because it does bring a parasympathetic release. But it also can become addictive, and that it also is can be damaging in relationships and that type of thing, you know. So any of those things that are addictive can be, you know, you drink a little wine because it relaxes you. Well, how about three glasses of wine then versus one? You know, that anything used to excess can turn the other way, but those things do, they dump the dopamine into us, you know, playing phone games, playing video games, you get these hits of dopamine, even sometimes with you know, texting and stuff like that. We can get to the place where you're just, especially the teenagers, you know, their life depends on the response to the text that I just sent out, or the tweet, or the whatever, you know, that these things literally cause dopamine to dump into our system, and it's that immediate relief. So I keep doing it, you know.
I'll jump in after Frida, since she mentioned, you know, coping with addiction stuff. So I've been feeling that way lately too. Like, I need to know how to self-soothe and to help myself. I need to learn these things first and foremost for me, and then I can help my clients. And, you know, a lot of my life, I was living in that activated state, you know, with toxic relationships and toxic emotional stuff and drugs and alcohol and violence and just all that garbage. I think I was just living in that activated state for so long. And my muscles will remind me of that now even. And so it's, how can I be a blessing to my body? How can I learn to breathe? How can I learn to calm down? How can I learn to do things in a healthier manner? And even recently, I think I've mentioned it on here, but my daughter, my only child that I raised and am bonded to, her and her husband and my grandbaby moved to Vermont. And that was really hard for me. And so it was like, okay, that's where the rubber meets the road, is like, I am in full on grief of my daughter and granddaughter moving so far away when I was spending so much time with them. But it was even on the plane back, you know, thinking, how do I calm myself down? I didn't even know if I could get on the plane to come back home without my girls, and then calming myself down on the plane. And then even when I got back home, you know, the first couple weeks, I mean, I would just be sobbing in my house, and I would catch myself. I would be patting myself on my chest saying, it's going to be okay. It's going to be okay. It's going to be okay. And I mean, that's something I've never done before. And I kept thinking of Lance when Lance taught about how children need to hear, it's going to be okay. And it was like, I realized that that's, I was telling myself, it's going to be okay. It's going to be okay. And then of course it's, you're patting your chest. And so that's, you know, mimicking the heart or whatever. And so all these things, you know, I'm realizing, you know, it's stuff I've learned in class, and it's just learning these techniques that are a blessing, and it's learning just healthier ways to cope with life.
Amen. I love it. And isn't it interesting how you just, you're not even thinking of it, and you just start that self-soothing thing. You know, that's the rocking that we do, the lots of stuff like that. That's why we have rocking chairs.
I was going to say, I find that when you stand around moms, everybody rocks together. Even if you don't have a baby, you rock with them. That is a thing. For me, I really enjoyed thinking about what I have used in the past and what I'm using now. And for me, I like to feel things. So I notice that sometimes at night when I get, like, I can't sleep, I have satin on my blankie. And so I feel it. And I do realize that it does calm me. I've done the tapping too. That was a new one. That's really cool. Very helpful. When I'm seriously having trouble falling asleep, I've prayed. I felt like I've laid all my burdens down. I've been quoting scripture, but my mind's still racing. But if I do that, I do find that pretty soon I'm asleep, which is a good thing. The other thing, I do like to picture things. And it's funny, I try also not only to have the picture, but to have the smell. Because I thought that was important. We talked about that in classes about, and when you were talking about Peter and when he was reconciled back to Jesus after he betrayed him, that you talked about the smell of the fire. He was in a fire, I mean, around a fire when he talked bad about Jesus, when he denied him. So I was just thinking about that, to try to think also about those smells, because sometimes they, for me, they're very calming. I love to smell things and I love to touch things. So I'm all about lighting candles, which drives my husband crazy, but if it feels good for me, it's soothing and it does help me relax. And of course, breathing always helps, but it was good hearing all these things and hearing what people say and how it really can affect your physiology. It's not just all in your head. Part of it is your body too reacting. So I don't know, it was good. I enjoy listening to other people's stuff too. It's good.
Okay, so I have something. that you might especially like, Sherry. I found this. Can you see this? It's an essential oil that's labeled, the title's or whatever, it's parasympathetic. And it's a combination of lime and clove. Anyway, and I just love the smell because I bought it because of the name, right? Because I learned, yeah. And anyway, that doesn't do it all for me, but you mentioned smell. I really like deep breathing. That helps me a lot. And I have been singing in the past few years, and there's a whole lot of breath involved in singing. And the chorus that I was in, sorry, am I sitting off?
Oh, no, you're good.
The chorus that I was in disbanded because of COVID. We just lost a lot of people, and it was already small to begin with. And that's something I'm still grieving. Woo, boy, how about that? I didn't think those emotions were going to come out so easily. But one thing that I realized is that I'm pretty sensitive to sound. And even just, you know, so not like I was in love with that director or anything, she's a woman, but I got used to hearing the sound of her voice once a week, just for a few hours. And it was associated with singing, which is breathing, and with around a lot of other women. So it was always a very happy moment. So the sound of her voice, and I won't let her know that, because that would just, she would just go, what a freak. But I just realized as I was thinking about her sound, the sound of her voice. And here's something else I wanted to mention. For me, a location being on the wet sand at the ocean's edge is really calming. It's all, just being there is calming, but imagining it is also calming. Because I imagine that how it makes me feel, and that just everything about it calms me down. And interestingly, several years ago, after that injury that I had, I was at a location that they were trying to help several of us calm down, just learn how to relax. And so I think, you know, we're like lying on the ground, you know, closing our eyes and relaxing. And so they started playing this tape like that. I'm so old fashioned, a tape. But anyway, started playing this recording of like ocean waves crashing and stuff. And that was very relaxing to most people, but to me, it completely stressed me out. Because I was injured in a sailboat race, and you know, when you're in the sailboat, like, I guess I've only done ocean racing, but I mean, I suppose anywhere, you know, where there's sand, where you're near the bottom, that's dangerous. You don't want that. And so to hear waves crashing means that you're near the ground, and that completely stressed me out, because here I was in this room with my eyes closed and just hearing it, and I went, oh my gosh. And so, you know, they were assuming that was going to be very relaxing to people, and it would be to most people, except as a sailor, I was like, no. Yet I think, yeah, so Jennifer asked me, well, you know, going to the beach, that doesn't stress you out? Well, no, it really doesn't. I had to think about it,
because when I'm
standing on the beach at the wet, on the wet sand, I know where I am. You know, I know that I can see the waves crashing, and I'm not afraid that I'm gonna you know, break the boat, because I know there is no boat around. But when I was in a room, wasn't on a boat or anything, it was just a room, listening to that, I was completely removed and imagining like if I were on a sailboat. Anyway, so the point was that what can be really stressful to one person isn't to another, or you might think it's relaxing, but it might not be to a person. So I guess you gotta check, right? What they're playing.
Yeah. And that's what I asked her to share that experience, because it's kind of like what Marion experienced listening to that song. that when you're with a client, don't assume what's going to be soothing to them, because there will be some who are triggered by stuff that's soothing. I remember going through the body relaxation, you know, where you're starting at your feet and going through your whole body, and in a class one time with quite a few people, and had a couple of people that said, man, I just wanted to get up and run. It just made me antsy, you know? So learn about your client and learn about yourself, and know that no matter what, if your body's sending off danger signals, just notice that, you know, and your danger signals, Colleen, could have been from sailing in general. It might have been part of the brain injury thing too, that you were on the ocean, you were in the water when that accident happened.
Yeah, you know, partially that. But that was a time of my life when I was doing a lot of ocean sailing.
Uh-huh.
And so I had learned about all that. And yeah, I mean, there was another ocean sailboat experience, which was very stressful and traumatic, but it wasn't this one where I was in.
Uh-huh.
So it could have been that too.
Yeah. Okay, who wants to jump in next?
Now, our group in here talked a lot about scents, smells.
Why don't you move up? Yeah, move up so that they can see you.
I can see your beautiful face.
I'll go back there.
Hi. We talked a lot about smells, and essential oils were a big thing for me just to immediately relax. I have a hard time relaxing in general. I was talking about that. I'm really bad at this. I need to do a lot of work on this, figuring out how to relax. But eucalyptus is a big one for me. I just remembered, because it takes me back to when I worked at Nike, and at lunchtimes I go work out, the most relaxing thing ever was being in the sauna where they were pumping in eucalyptus smell in it. And usually it was just me in there. I was alone, and it was just beautiful. But I love quiet. There's so much noise around all the time. Mm-hmm. My most relaxing is just super quiet. I make myself go to a yoga class every Monday morning. I mean, I really just force myself to get there, because it's a big deal to get there. I'm always rushing around, but then for that hour, I can't do anything else but stretch and relax. I have a 7-month-old puppy, a golden doodle named Bear, that looks like a huge stuffed animal, is what everybody says.
He's gorgeous.
He's so cute. I'll send you guys a picture. He makes me relax, which is a good thing. It was in the morning, he's used to getting his tummy rubbed in bed. So he jumps up on the bed and looks at me like, well, aren't you going to hug me and massage me? And so makes me for 10 minutes just sit down and hug him and rub his tummy. And then that relaxes me. So I have to kind of trick myself in relaxing, which I don't know, maybe the case might have clients like that. And then in Wednesday morning group, I just remember too, Teresa gave us assignment to do something different as an experience, which I'm still getting through listening to Betty's things. I had a schedule conflict, but to do something we either haven't done before ever, or pick up something again that we did a long time ago. And so for me, my goal this week, I still haven't done it, but I'm gonna do it in the next few days, is to pick my flute back up, because in high school, I was like third in state playing Carnival of Venice. And when I picked it up, like a year ago, I still could remember, miraculously it seems, playing about 80% of it. Mm-hmm. I mean, I could.
Body memory.
What is that?
Body memory.
Body memories. I mean, that was insane for me to like relate that wow, this has been like 20 years. And yeah, picked it up. So thanks. So that's my goal. So maybe everybody can have that little goal. Do something you haven't done before within a week.
Cool. So, good assignment. I love it. Yeah. And what you're talking about there, the body memory, is another word for it is procedural memory. So things that we learn as a procedure, like playing musical instruments, and you, how do you memorize that piece?
And over and over.
Over and over and over. It's repetitive.
Yeah.
And there's a procedure. Playing the piano would be the same way. Or any musical instrument, that your muscle patterns follow this same pattern over and over and over, and you don't even think about it. It's in your body, it's memory, and it just comes back out through your hands, through your voice, through whatever. It's fascinating. But procedural memory is something God designed into us, or we would go insane. What if you had to think about every single move you made when you drive a car?
Yeah.
When you start, it's that way. You know, I remember my grandson the last few years ago learning to drive, and it was terrifying being in the car with him because he had to think about, oh, step on the brake. Not that hard. Turn on your signal. Do I change lanes yet? Oh, no, I shouldn't have changed lanes.
Oh, no, it's hard. Yeah.
You know, those things that become automatic. I mean, even simple things like tying your shoes. A procedural memory is something you repeat over and over and over and over until it becomes a memory in your body and you don't forget it. That's why they say, you know, oh, riding a bicycle.
Yeah.
You don't forget how to ride a bicycle. You might be a little wobbly getting back on, but it won't take long to pick it back up. Yeah. Repetition. Practice makes perfect.
That's true. I learned that practice doesn't make perfect. Practice makes permanent.
Yes. That's a good word. Practice makes permanent. And that's it. It goes into long-term memory storage. And that's not just in your brain. It's in your physiology. It's in your muscles. It's in your bones.
So if you do the same thing, the same wrong thing over and over again, that's what's going to come out is the wrong thing.
Good point. If you practice the bad thing over and over, that's going to become a procedural memory, just like something good. Yeah.
So our singing director would not let us sing initially because unless there were things there to help us correct us, because she didn't want us to get in the habit of singing it wrong. Because you hear it and you feel it. Mm-hmm. And so we had to, I was like, really? Mm-hmm. Yeah, apparently it's a big deal.
It is. Okay, who's next? Mama Hannah, I want to hear from you.
Yeah, I'm so grateful for the class, and thank you so much, Mama Cindy, for sharing and for the training and all my classmates. This is so helpful, and it's something that we really needed at such a time as this to share and to brainstorm and to receive all the training. So like Frida shared when she came back, how we shared, she told us about those destructive behaviors that she told us about that are not good to do. And we also shared about how we have here the TLC groups whereby we have children on Sundays and we have teenagers and youth. They come around, they talk, we listen, care, we laugh around, they pour out what they're experiencing. Like for example, they have spent like 2 years without going to school. They had gone and then they came back. And this last round when they came back, some of them came back when they were sick, and some of those kids made their parents sick, and some parents had to pass on. So they have that guilt. Oh my God, I went to school. I brought home COVID and my parents died. It's my fault. It's like, you know, so if they don't have where they can share and talk about it, you find that they have been saying that you have been depressed, you don't have anyone to talk about it, no one can, you know, can know that it's not our fault. But when they come around, we talk about it, they share, they open up, they tell us about it, and we tell them how it is. They are fearfully and wonderfully made. God has a plan for each and every one. It is not their fault not to judge themselves and to see that like it's not their fault. Like it is good for them to know that yes, it happened, but how are they going to deal with them? So that's calling on community, whereby they share with each other. And after that, we do the grounding exercises whereby we breathe in, breathe out, and we also do that dancing. We put the music and dance, and we have been doing several things. We eat together, we jump around, we play, and by the time someone goes back home, they are not the same way as they came in, because they were saying we are staying inside and most of the time spending time, those who have phones, spending time on phones in isolation. And this said, when we talked about what are the benefits of you coming in this space, they said, I have learned not to look at my problem, knowing that someone cares, someone is walking along with me, and it has encouraged me to know that I have a sister who's out there praying for me, encouraging me, believing in me. It is very, very important to believe in them, to believe in each and every one, and more so believe in themselves, that we have shared affirming words whereby you say, I am fearfully and wonderfully made. I am beautiful. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. There is no one of me of the kind. I am unique. I am special. So we use a talking stick whereby someone gets to hold on the talking stick. We share it back and forth like that. And it has built their self-esteem. It has built the connection, the networking, and always they look forward to come and share. And more so, not only them, but also the mothers. We don't call them mothers, we call ourselves sisterings, whereby a single mother comes in, a married woman can come in, a mother comes in, and we share also back and forth. We talk about experiences in parenting, like someone's experience, how can you balance work, parenting, and being a wife, and all those kind of stuff. So all these spaces have been been helpful, and it has, people have shared their emotions, carried you know, like many things, because we don't have here vaccines. They are talking about the vaccines are not enough, and yet they want the kids to be vaccinated and other people to be vaccinated to see that they go back to school. There's still some things that have to be put in place for them to go back to school. But they look forward to that. As they're looking forward to go back to school, these spaces have really helped them to build the self-confidence and not to look at their problem, knowing that I am not a problem, but if I share and I carry someone's burden and they carry my burden, we hold hands up. We don't give them a handout, but it is a holding hands up. We hold each and everyone's hand up, and we get to move. And we know that, you know, the best is yet to come. We just keep our eyes looking forward, not to look behind of what has happened, what is not happening, but what is the best, to know that the best is yet to come. And yeah, that everyone's life is going to be better. We are different, and we just carry our burdens to him, and we laugh. We have to make ourselves laugh. Words of affirmation have done a lot, encouraging someone's self. We use a mirror, said you go in at home, if you don't have someone to, you know, you talk to you about that, you talk to yourself. For example, you tell them, Hannah is beautiful. Hannah is lovely. Oh, Hannah, the mother, daughter of the Most High God. You will go around, you twist you smile. And by the time you get out of that mirror, surely you will be feeling very good and very encouraged. Yes, thank you.
And Hannah, you have in your country and in lots of Africa, you have the very natural music and movement that is a part of your everyday lives, you know, that it's the music there and the movement is so fluid and everybody is involved in it, you know. And around here, it's like people feel weird if they dance or raise their hands or get too, you know, boisterous in church or whatever. But there, it's part of your culture. And it's just, I mean, oh my gosh, I will never forget my first day driving, going in on the bus into the school at Masaka. It was just the most phenomenal. We had the marching band of the kids. meet us at the gate. And they had stayed until way late at night because we were like 3 hours late getting there and it was dark. And these kids are chanting and singing and dancing and playing musical instruments and holding up signs with our names on them. And then they put on this full-blown performance of dancing. And it was mind-boggling. I got awesome videos of a lot of it. But that's just such a beautiful, beautiful, natural form of engaging that healing part of us that God created in us. And so, yeah, Hannah, use that. It's beautiful. And to get up and to see what you go through, Hannah, with the routines with the children in the morning, you know, all of these kids outside, what, like 1,400 kids on this stair-stepped area, and they're all singing and worshiping God and playing drums and doing plays and all kinds of amazing engagement with community and with God. It's beautiful. Yeah. So thank you, Hannah, for sharing.
Thank you so much. Thank you too, Mama.
I wish Hannah could spend time with every child in the world. So beautiful what you do.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay.
So Cindy, I'm gonna share real quick. I'm watching out the window. I might have to get off because one of my sons is coming to celebrate birthday. So, but a couple of weeks ago, I had a real low week. I usually, it doesn't happen to me where I feel like really depressed and fatigued and tired, and I just was really struggling. And so I finally just had to sit down. Because I mean, I have devotions every morning, but it just wasn't, my devotions were just not, they were just really shallow. And so I just really had to sit down and cry out to God and seek his face. And the Holy Spirit showed up, and it was so helpful because I had more physical energy and I didn't feel depressed anymore. So I was really thankful for that. But another thing that's been, I've been doing that's new to me is because one of my horses has some serious issues and needs a chiropractor, I am learning to do some body work with her. And it relaxes me so much. I mean, I'm doing it for her, but it's really relaxing me a lot.
You, yeah.
And so I was quite amazed at how much it helps me relax when I do the body work for her.
Uh-huh. And if you want chiropractic in between, Terry and I can come out because he works on horses a lot.
Well, please come. I'll pay your gas. She definitely needs help.
Who has a chair? Vicki, Ruth Ann. Mary?
I'll share just one thing. I find that a long hug does a lot to relax me, especially if I'm very worked up. I remember when I'd gotten a tear in my retina, and I didn't know that's what it was until I went to the eye doctor, and I just casually mentioned that I was having these flashers, and she took a good close look at my eye and said that you need to have surgery today or tomorrow. And after I saw her, and you know, I got it scheduled for the next day, and I went home, and just after I got home, my young adult son walks in the door, and I just went up to him and said, I need a hug. So that's just one example, but I find a long hug from somebody that cares about me and that I care about to be extremely helpful in helping me to let down.
Yeah. Yeah. Touch. We're all touch deprived. Thank you, Marion.
So I can't really think of anything real specific I do, except I go to the Holy Spirit, and lots of times he will lead me to do something, or when I'm in those times and I just can't think, I have done the, you know, the tapping on each side and tapping and that type of thing. But I have realized that the Holy Spirit has told me that I carry peace. And so I remind myself of that and the enemy, you know, and I carry peace and mercy carries me. Mm-hmm. And you know, I try to say that every morning. And so I guess maybe lately there's just been a whole lot of things that God has been teaching me about to be proactive even before, because I have a daughter living here with us, and so and four kids, and so you know, being proactive every morning is a good way of doing it. But and I guess another but also the proclaiming that you were talking about, and you know, because I've just proclaimed, and it's like, no, my Father is the creator of the universe, and I am totally under all protection and care and provision, you know, for under him. And so just proclaiming those things, and you know, and to it's just been something that helps really well. Otherwise I do like singing, and there's just sometimes when I just have to sit and watch a good horse movie. So I'm kind of in there with you horse people, but with something like that. But I love, or also I'll find a movie that I know that it looks like it's going to have a lot of countryside, you know, I just, you know, the farm girl in me, I guess, is just something that just really, really just is, yeah, helps me to relax. And so that's kind of some of them. But.
All right. Thanks, Ruben. Vicki, you haven't shared yet.
It seems like I shared a lot in the group, so I feel like I shared a lot already. you know, God's a God of variety, and it seems like there's so many different things that could be done. And I find depends on the situation, what happened, you know, I mean, how God works with me. And one of the things that I did share was that I have a whole bunch of different prayers. There's the generational prayers, there's the trauma prayers, and then, you know, there's just different ones that I've gotten over the years. And so if I'm really in trauma and I'm trying to sleep and I'm just going, man, I don't know what's going on with me, God will remind me to pull that out and then pray those prayers.
And I am just amazed that I'm just going, wow, God, I was able to just give it to you. And sometimes I have to write things out just to help, you know, get rid of some of it. But a lot of times it's those prayers and I going, wow, you know, I'm up at 3 a.m. and I'm just going, you know, all this time just going through stuff. And then when God tells me that, I go, hi, why didn't I do that earlier? I could have slept more.
Yeah. Great. Thank you. I know I find when I can't sleep at night, I might as well just get up and go pray or read or do something that the Lord's leading me to do, because I won't go back to sleep if I just lay there and flop around a bit. Okay, I think we lost Susanna somewhere along the line. I don't see her here anymore. Did everybody get a chance to share? Okay, so I want to remind everybody that we have the Good Samaritan Ministries annual summer picnic that we had to miss last summer because of COVID, but it's out at Candace and Marty Miller's house. I don't know whether they put the address on the website or not. I can put it in the chat box probably. They live over in Washougal, so it takes a little while to get out there. But it's worth it. They have an awesome place with a lot of acreage in this big pond. And I know that there's somebody that's bringing their son and going to get baptized out there this weekend. We've had a number of baptisms at this party every year. But it's lots of fun. You just bring a side dish and Candace and Marty provide all of the meat and condiments and hamburgers and I think hot dogs and stuff like that. And then we have all the side dishes and there's usually way overkill of food. And it sounds like the weather's going to be perfect. It's going to be in the low 80s, I think. So let me look up their address and I will type it into the chat.
Oh, what time is it?
Oh, thank you. It's at 3:00 in the afternoon. Okay, so the address is 48808 Northeast Washougal River Road in Washougal, Washington. Make sure I typed that in right. 48808 Northeast Washougal River Road. There you go. So it's ways out there, but like it's worth the drive. It's beautiful. They got kind of walking trail that goes up through the trees and stuff. Yeah. I have a feeling Mama Betty will be there. She usually is. And typically we've had international people here. We've had Egypt and we've had people from Kenya. And so we always give time for them to do some sharing. But what we'll probably do is just have different people from the different satellites get up and share a little bit about what's going on in the different countries with their satellites. And yeah, it will be an awesome time.
Is it this Saturday?
This Saturday.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, anything else anybody needs to say, thoughts that you have before we close?
I was saying earlier that our group had horses in common.
Uh-huh.
That it occurred to me how much God leads us for the community that we need.
Mm-hmm.
How he brings us to people, who help one another and strengthen one another and share with one another.
Mm-hmm.
It's really amazing.
That was
what it does for us that we do not realize is amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's why I really wanted you to make a deliberate pay a deliberate attention to those things that bring soothing and calming to you, because there's probably a whole lot more things than you've noticed.
Yeah.
So be noticing those things. Yeah. And go, oh yeah, oh, that makes me feel good. Brings me down off the ceiling. Or it wakes me up and gets me going. Yeah. Okay. Anything else?
Can we bring friends to the picnic on Saturday? Yeah.
Absolutely. Bring friends.
Okay.
Because once they show up at a Samaritan event, they're a Samaritan forever. Okay. Who'd like to close us in prayer tonight? I'm starting to hum the Jeopardy song. Come on.
I will.
Okay. Thank you, Ruthann.
Father, you are just so precious to all of us. And I just thank you so much for bringing this group together and just the things that we have in common, like you were talking about the horses, Lord. That's just so you to be so, just the little things that can connect us, Lord, that you use. And we just want to praise you for the way that you are working in each of our lives. And Father, I just pray now for a blessing over all of these ladies and men in this group, Lord, that you are sending out,
mm-hmm.
like Isaiah 61 says, because we are under your spirit, and to bring forth healing. And yeah, Lord, it's just one of those things that's really needed at this time. I just thank you for the army that you're bringing together and that we're a part of that.
Yeah. Yes.
Thank you, Lord. We love you in your precious name. Amen.
Amen. And amen. And Christy, I need to talk to you.
Bye.
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 Thank you.
Bye.
This has been good.
I'll be sending out more information here next week, probably.
Cindy, could I ask you one quick question?
Sure.
Regarding when I do my report, did you say about 40 minutes?
You can take as much time as you need from the class.
Or as little time.
Or, yeah.
Okay, I got it.
You know, especially if you engage the group in some type of interaction, you'd be amazed how fast the time goes.
Okay.
Yeah. And we can, if you want to do something where people go into breakout groups, let me know, because I can put them into the groups for you.
Yeah, I was thinking that I would try to do something like that.
Yeah. Good. It'll be fun.
Okay.
Okay. Looking forward to it.
Okay. Take care.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Christy.
Hi.
I have a big request of you.
Okay.
Would you like to be one of our speakers at the banquet?
Sure.
Yeah.
When's the banquet?
It is October 2nd. It's a Saturday.
Okay, yes. I knew it was in October, and I'm going to Vermont in October, so I wanted to make sure it wasn't
Yeah, right at the first. So yeah, it's about, you know, 10 minutes max, but you know, 7 to 10 minutes, something like that. And I can work with you to hone and kind of package what it is that you want to say, I have a format that I use from a little book called Made to Stick. And it's how to give an impactful message in a short time, you know, the pieces that need to be there in order to tell a story in a short time. But you've heard some of the testimonies, and so you know how impactful that few minutes can be.
Yeah.
In speaking. So awesome.
Cool. And where is this at?
It's going to be at the golf club again, the Portland Golf Club.
Okay.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah. So we can get together and talk about it in more detail, because I'm going to speak too. I'm going to speak about international experience with Good Samaritan. That's something that we've not done at our banquets. We've always focused on the local work, but we've been hearing that we really need to let the audience see the big picture of Good Samaritan Ministries and what we are. So I'm going to share that. Yeah.
Great.
Great.
Okay.
Uh-huh. I knew you'd say yes, because it was the Lord's idea.
Good.